So today I'm going to talk about architecting a virtual infrastructure. And the main thing that I want to emphasize today that it's not about actually building it, but it's about making the right plans and executing on those plans, because that's the most important thing if you ask me. So the agenda by itself is fairly straightforward. I will do a short introduction. I will discuss some of the design methodology. And then I will go over some of the design patterns. And then hopefully we'll have some time left for the Q&A. But considering I have about 40 slides, that's going to be pretty tight, I guess. So as mentioned, my name is Duncan Epping. I'm a principal architect working for VMware. And I'm actually part of R&D these days. So I'm part of the integration engineering team, as they call it. And basically what I do during the day is what you guys do during the day as well. So I play with our solution software, try to figure out how it works. And if it doesn't work, I'll file a bug, and hopefully the engineers will solve it for us. So that's my main job role. So if you hit any issues or are experiencing, for instance, severe issues in your environment, don't hesitate to let me know during the day as well. So just come up, have a chat about what kind of issues you're facing, and hopefully VMware can solve them for you in the future. So as I just mentioned, the session is about designing a VMware-based infrastructure. It was originally intended to be an interactive session, so if you have any comments, questions, feedback, specific experience you had during the creation of a design or during the implementation, feel free to speak up. I understand it's difficult as a non-native speaker, but realize most of the people here are non-native speakers. So am I, so it's okay if you make mistakes. So let's get into it straight away. First of all, let me ask a question. Have people actually read Scott Lowe's design book? So I read the design book, and this is probably one of the principles that's part of the design book. And the reason I wanted to emphasize this is the phase that a lot of people, when they do an architecture, actually skip. Everyone wants to dive into the actual technology bit itself. But the most important part, if you ask me, is you start off with the vision. You sit down with your customer. You try to figure out what their plans are, what their ultimate goal is essentially to get out of the solution that you're building, and that's the kind of stuff that you're going to document. Now, out of that comes an architecture, and part of that architecture is not just an architectural document, but that could also contain, for instance, a test plan, but also operational guidance, for instance, on how to manage an environment. Now, after you created this architecture, it's time to do some planning, and that's also typically a phase that a lot of people skip. What I've seen out in the past is that a sales guy comes in, he pitches a project, and he says, well, it's going to take us 3 weeks. Well, how does he know that it's going to take them 3 weeks? Because he hasn't actually spoken about the architecture itself. That's typically what you guys should be for, or at least you guys should be doing. Make sure that he doesn't sell a three-week project. Well, in reality, it might be 6 weeks, 9 weeks, or who knows, maybe even 12 months. So as soon as you've done the planning, that's the point where you actually get into the real implementation itself, which is what we call the transition phase. So this is where we actually implement what we've architected. Now, this is typically the shortest part of the overall project, and that's what surprises a lot of people. The majority of the time actually goes into the architecture, and typically the implementing part is just fitting the components or placing components in the right spots. Now, as soon as you've done that, in my opinion, comes the most critical phase of any project, and that's the manage aspect. In other words, sit down with your customer, show them what you've created. Not only show them what you've created, but actually show them how they should be managing it. Because if they're not managing it correctly, although you might have built a really great environment, it looks awesome, you got all the right components in there, EMC, VMAX, fastest HP blades, you name it. If they don't know how to manage it, if they set it up incorrectly, I'm sure your project in the end will fail. And the customer won't be happy, so they won't be coming back. Now, I did this session at Partner Exchange at VMworld, or at Partner Exchange in Las Vegas. And we started talking about gathering input. And we had a room full of consultants. So my first question was, what's the first thing you do when you start a project? And no one really had the answer. It's fairly simple. You start talking to your customer. And the whole room started laughing, but the majority of the people never really had a conversation with the customer about what their ultimate goal was. What do you want to get out of this project, right? We understand you want to virtualize some applications, but what exactly is that about? Are there any specific business drivers, for instance? And we'll get into that into a second as well. But as soon as you have those discussions, make sure when you have those discussions, you actually document some of the decisions or some of the comments made by your customers. Because I can guarantee you some of the decisions made along the way, at some point the customer is going to say, well, you know, I never told you to do that. I'm pretty sure you did. It's documented over here and you actually sign it off. So as soon as you start documenting, make sure you document these constraints, requirements, assumptions, risks, all of those things, because they are fairly important to the success of any project. So as I just said, the thing that you always want to talk about first is what would you like to achieve? In most of the projects I've been, it's either cost reduction, or for instance, it's time to market for a specific business unit, or it's increasing resiliency, for instance. So those are the things you typically want to figure out. Now, what I always do in a design is I try to visualize, for instance, what our goal is. So in this case, this is an example of decreasing the time to market for a specific application for a business unit. So I've done probably hundreds of these type of projects where the big question was, how can we reduce the amount of time needed to deploy a specific service for our customers? I said, well, virtualization is the first step, but then what? So I did a project at a large bank, and this was more or less the process that they had set up. So they had a virtualization layer in place, and the standing up a virtual machine took about 5 minutes. Standing up multiple virtual machines and some storage and networking took about a day. So how long do you think the change process was for that full day of work? It was about 6 weeks. So it's not only about making changes to the infrastructure itself, but making sure that the people understand that those changes will also need to be reflected in the organization itself. So the organization will need to adopt the technology that you're proposing. So in this case, for instance, the vision could be creating a software-defined data center. And Scott more or less also mentioned software-defined networking. This morning explained some of the technology. Of course, that's part of it. Cormac is going to discuss software-defined storage this afternoon, so make sure you attend that session as well. Now, when you go through the discussions with your customer, in my opinion, there's always one thing that really stands out. That's the center. And when I created this diagram on the lower left or the lower right for you guys, there's a reason the application is in the middle. It's something that a lot of the infrastructure architects tend to forget. The virtual machine itself or the hardware that it's running on is not really that important, right? So it's nice that you have HP or Dell or IBM or whichever vendor it may be. But in the end, your customer is only going to care about the application itself. Is it up running? And is it performing as it should be performing? That's the only thing your customer will care about typically. It's about the availability and the performance of your application. It's not about the type of hardware that you're running. And that's the kind of stuff that you will need to document as well. So what does that typically look like? Is anyone a VMware consultancy partner in the room by any chance? Okay, so for most of the people, this is new. If you've ever seen these guys, what they normally should do, or in my opinion, what they should go through, is they should document some of these business requirements. Now, in this case that I already mentioned, I just pulled out a random one, which is B104, provisioning based on predefined policies, because it fits nicely with the software-defined data center theme. But that could, for instance, be a business requirement. Another one could be lowering the time to market, as I already mentioned, or increasing availability for our applications. But make sure you document these, because this is typically what a customer signs off on. Now, of course, there is also the technical aspect. Do we need to integrate with specific systems? Is there some sort of CNDB system that we need to integrate with? How do we integrate with it? Is there some sort of front-end portal that people should be using for self-provisioning? I know Massimo will probably scream, hey, we've got VCD for that, but there are also other systems out there that we could integrate with, for instance. Another option would be orchestrating, for instance, disaster recovery. If that's a technical requirement, you know you're going to have limitations in the type of products or solutions you can offer, right? Although you can fully script a DR solution, scripting a DR solution isn't, for instance, as reliable as using Site Recovery Manager. So based on those technical requirements and business requirements, you can start determining what kind of products, features you need to have in your solution. Now, the constraints part technically or typically for a lot of people has a negative aspect to it. They feel they are more or less bound to a specific solution. Now, constraints to me aren't really negative. It's not something negative. The fact that I have a NetApp array is not a negative thing. It's just I need to be able to use that in my platform or in my solution by itself. So I need to take that into account when I start doing my architecture, because it's going to drive some of the other decisions that I make. If I have a NetApp array, there might be specific requirements from a networking perspective. There might be specific requirements from a connection perspective, if you look at it from the host side. So that all of these constraints might at some point drive some of the decisions that you make. And then, of course, there's the list of assumptions. Now, assumptions are things that typically you haven't validated or verified with your customers. So in other words, you're assuming that sufficient power and cooling is available. And it's a typical mistake I've seen. A lot of people actually assume that sufficient power and cooling is available. And when they power on the VMAX, they figure that, hey, it's actually consuming a lot more power than I expected, and the whole environment goes down. Or there's only one power lag coming into the building, right? And if there's a power cut for whatever reason, whole data center freezes up. And I've seen that happening at hospitals, for instance, which is not a pretty sight when that happens. For instance, sufficient backspace available, again, something that a lot of people assume, typically something that, in my opinion, you should be validating. I'm guessing most of the people are here to get to know more about design patterns or at least the technical aspect of it. So I carved it up in multiple sections. First of all, the sizing and scaling. Secondly, I will discuss some of the hosts consideration, networking, storage, and some of the virtual constructs like HA clustering, DRS, vCenter data centers, things like that. So we've already mentioned the use case and what an environment looks like. Again, for your design patterns by itself, this is really important as well. So why is this important? Just think about vCenter, for instance. A vCenter, when you create a new environment, the first thing you need to do is create a virtual data center. So are you going to create one, or are you going to create multiple virtual data centers, and what's the impact of that? So how many people realize that if you create multiple vCenters or multiple virtual data centers or data centers within vCenter server that you can't actually migrate virtual machines between those two data centers? So a data center is a vMotion boundary. It's not only a vMotion boundary, it's also a boundary for your virtual distributed switch, for instance. So as soon as you start going over these decisions, yeah, you might have multiple sites, but although you have multiple sites, you might want to have a single data center so you can still move virtual machines around between those clusters, for instance. So take things like that into consideration. Now, as soon as you start doing sizing and scaling, the one thing, in my opinion, that's really important to do is create some sort of report. Has anyone seen, for instance, VMware Capacity Planner reports? So I've done various of these exercises, and the nice thing about these reports is that they always typically look the same. So from a compute perspective, networking perspective, the diagrams all look similar. There's a reason for it. Most of the environments out there were underutilized. So there's a couple of hosts, a couple of operating system applications that do require a lot of compute resources. 90-95% of your applications don't. So all of them end up looking the same. So why do we create these reports? What are you looking for? Well, you're looking for some of the peak values. Because as soon as you start doing sizing and scaling, you need to make sure that not only you'll be able to cater for the average, for instance, but also for those peak moments. So there might be a virtual machine or an application that does 5,000 IOPS once a month just because people are running a report, or it's driving 500 megabyte per second worth of network traffic. That's the kind of stuff that you want to figure out from a report like this. And as I said, mostly these will look the same, so you really need to try to spot these peak values. So as soon as you figured out what the estate looks like, so how many virtual machines would I end up with, what's the total amount of resources that are required, amount of megahertz, amount of gigahertz, gigabytes, storage, networking, now what? So you're going to try to figure out how many hosts you'll need, how many LANs you will need, or how many performance those LANs will drive. And for instance, in the case of a host, you need to try to figure out how many virtual machines do I want to run on a single host. So how many people are running more than 50 VMs on a host? Just a couple. Anyone more than 100? More than 150? Not a lot. Okay. So 100 virtual machines on the host is, you know, it's pretty substantial. It's a fairly significant amount. So what happens if that host fails? It means that 100 virtual machines will need to be restarted at some point. So that's going to have an impact on the environment. Not only will it have an impact on storage, because you will see a massive boot storm, but it might also have an impact on, for instance, the other virtual machines that are sitting on the same host. So if you're running 100 virtual machines on the host, it might be smart to have, let's say, 16 or, you know, depending on the size of the environment, of course, but a relative large amount of hosts as well, because at least when there is a failover, when a failover occurs, the virtual machines are balanced across multiple multiple hosts. Now, the other thing is, what about maintenance? So how long do you think it takes when you enter maintenance mode for a single host, when there's 100 virtual machines sitting there? I can tell you it typically takes, if you're unlucky, 30 minutes. If you're unlucky, it could take 4 hours. Because it's going to fully depend on the application itself, what the application is doing, the amount of memory blocks that are changing, because memory blocks are being copied over when a vMotion occurs. And if there's a lot of changes, it will need to keep on copying and copying and copying. And that could take a while. I guess the good news is, with vSwift 5.0 and 5.1, we made a lot of changes to vMotion itself. So you can have multiple NICs for vMotion, for instance. You can have multiple 10 gig NICs even. So this has reduced the time that it takes to migrate virtual machines significantly. The other cool thing in vSwift 5.0 and 5.1, in my opinion, is what we call SDPS, slow down during page send. So what if you have multiple sites and the VM needs to be migrated, but there's a significant amount of latency on the connection between those sites? In the old days, 4.1 and before, the vMotion would simply fail, would just stop. And if you're lucky, your VM would still be up and running. If you're unlucky, you were in kind of a shady state. You had a ghosted virtual machine, which was more or less already doing something, not a lot. And then there was a virtual machine up running, and you end up troubleshooting it. Now with 5.0, with slowdown during page send, what we did is we created this buffer size framework. So basically what it does, as soon as we notice that latency is going up, we change the buffer size for copying blocks between the hosts. So it's a fairly smart way of allowing vMotion to occur between sites with higher latency. And we can go up to 10 milliseconds. So for instance, for a stretched storage solution, stretched cluster solutions, it's quite useful. But as I just mentioned, we did these most of the enhancements basically to increase or to decrease the amount of time it takes to place a host in maintenance mode. So this is one of the tests that we did. And we'll be using the exact same bandwidth, but just by optimizing the way the vMotion internally works, there's a 5x improvement between 4.1 and 5.0. So for 4.1, so for 4.1, what they did is they had a 10 gig link. They tried an Ether channel. I don't know if people are using Ether channels or not. In my opinion, if you can avoid them, avoid them. And there's a good reason for it. I will come back to that in a second. But With 4.1, they tried an Ether channel. The thing with vMotion traffic is an Ether channel uses IP source destination hashing. If the source and the destination is the same, it always uses the same link. So although you have 2 or 4 or 8 links available in your Ether channel, because the source and the destination address is exactly the same, it will use the same link. Now, what we did with 5.0 is we allow you to create multiple VM kernels. So instead of doing Ether channels or whatever, you just create multiple VM kernels, and vSphere by itself decides which link it's going to use based on how it's utilized. That's one of the enhancements. On top of that, they more or less changed the algorithm that was part of vMotion as well. So they rewrote half of the vMotion stack just to make it more efficient. Sure. It's a combination of both. So they actually tested it with a single vMotion, a Veeam kernel as well, and it was still a 3-point-something enhancement. It's pretty significant. So especially in larger environments, if you're not running 4.1 yet or 5.0 yet, make sure you start upgrading, because you can significantly benefit when you're doing maintenance in the evening, right? This is the difference between being at home at 8 or being at home at 11 in the evening. And I'd rather be at home at 8. So networking. Scott already spoke about networking. And the typical thing with networking is you do all of these analysis. What I've seen most out in the field is that the average bandwidth consumption, we're talking about 4 Mbps. It's not more than that, not a lot more than that, except for during the backup times, because that's when the majority of the I/O happens over the network, depending on the backup solutions that they use. So you might want to take that into consideration. Now, the one thing, though, to keep in mind with network sizing, it is important what kind of services you're offering, right? If you're offering load balancing services, firewall services, it's the kind of stuff that you will need to keep in mind when you're sizing your network as well, not only from a bandwidth perspective, but, for instance, from a physical perspective, how many NICs do you have? Do you have a specific isolated DMZ, for instance? Are customers using VLANs? Are people actually not using VLANs today in the room? Yay. Actually, the last time I asked, there were 5 people raised their hands. They weren't using VLANs out of compliance and regulations that they had locally. So something that is frustrating and makes the environment fairly complex, because when you end up with 12 or 16 NICs, the vSwitch architecture is fairly complex, and it's difficult to manage as well. Now, storage sizing is typically where it gets interesting, because this is also typically, from a support perspective, where we get probably 90% or 85% of the calls on. If there's an issue, it's around storage. And typically, the issue is around storage performance. Although size does matter when you start doing your architecture, performance is also a critical part of it. And there's multiple things that will drive the performance of your environment. And for instance, one of those things could be the RAID level used. So as you've seen in the earlier slides, for instance, we were using a NetApp filer. Now, it's NetApp's best practice to use BaitDP, and there's a specific RAID overhead associated with that. That applies to every type of RAID solution that you have, right? So if it's EMC using RAID 5, or if it's whoever doing RAID 1, there's also always a specific type of overhead associated with it. So as soon as you start doing the math, make sure you know how many reads, writes, and what kind of RAID solution you'll end up using, because that's going to determine the amount of virtual machines you can have up and running on a single data store. Because if you did the math without knowing, for instance, what the RAID overhead was, and you figured out, hey, I have 42 IOPS on average, I can run 50 virtual machines on that data store from a sizing perspective, and from a read IOP perspective, it's, you know, sounds okay. The write IOP is actually where the overhead comes in, because every single write needs to be copied to multiple disks, depending on the RAID set or the RAID type you're using. So in that case, when there's one IO, it might actually end up being 4 IOs or 5 IOs, depending on the RAID set that you're using. Now, in the end, that's going to determine the performance for a virtual machine. So make sure you figure out, from a sizing and scaling perspective, what the IO pattern is. And the one thing I can recommend, so make sure you talk to your storage vendor about that, because it's going to differ per storage vendor. And they all have their own best practices. And they all have their own reporting tools. And every single time, the outcome will look different. Now, the other aspect that's really important in my opinion, and something that a lot of people seem to forget, is disaster recovery, or at least business continuity. So you figured out you can have 50 virtual machines running up on the data store, or 60, or maybe even 100. But what happens when that data store fails? Let's assume VMFS is corrupted. It doesn't happen too often, but it can happen, right? Then what? Well, at some point, you need to start restoring virtual machines. So you have an SLA internally which says within 8 hours, you need to be able to restore those virtual machines. Well, you had 100 virtual machines up running on the data store. It's 16 or 32 terabyte. Who knows? How long is it going to take you to actually restore those virtual machines? That is probably not going to take you 8 hours. It's probably going to be a lot longer than that. So as soon as you start creating that architecture, make sure you think about your failure scenario as well. So your failure domain. How many virtual machines, or at least from a failure perspective, what can I tolerate? 50 virtual machines might not sound like a lot, but when you have 150 virtual machines, it's one third of your estate which is gone. And I can tell you that your manager is going to be breathing down your neck to make sure you have these up and running as soon as possible. So you might want to take that into account as soon as you start doing your designs. Now, the other thing that I wanted to mention is the new storage solutions. Downstairs, there's a whole bunch of storage vendors. For instance, Nimbus Data is out there. I saw Fusion.io. There's a lot of SSD storage, a lot of hybrid storage out there today. The thing with these solutions is that a lot of people focus on the performance that they can offer, but there's also other advantages that they can offer. For instance, Rebuilding a RAID set typically takes a lot of time. For instance, on an EMC VNX, could take a day, who knows? On these systems, it could take an hour. So what happens if a second disk fails when it's rebuilding a RAID set? It might be that your whole, or at least the data store is gone. So the least amount of time needed is, in my opinion, something you should always go for. So if you have the option to look into different or new storage solutions, make sure you start looking into them. So when we're talking about hosts, we're primarily talking about CPUs, memory. We already mentioned that during the sizing, but for instance, does it really matter if you're using AMD versus Intel? I did the math a couple of times, and more or less, it ends up being the same. One of them offers more cores, the other offers more gigahertz, but if you look at it overall from a larger perspective, from a larger point of view, the amount of virtual machines that you can have running on a single host is still more or less the same. So what should you be looking at? Well, for instance, one of the things is cost. And I know most of the technical people are not really concerned about cost, but in the end, your management, your director might be, or he probably is. So when you start investigating new servers, make sure you investigate different options, because AMD, although it's less adopted than Intel, it's still a proven viable solution if you ask me. I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with Intel, by the way. Same goes to solutions like Blade or Rack. How does that change your design? A thing that a lot of people were forgetting, at least when they started out doing Blades, is it creates a lot of hotspots in your data center. So when I did my first virtual design, which was for an insurance company I worked for, our management forced us to start using Blade chassis. We didn't know what we were getting into. So we installed all of these new Blade chassis, and we had four of them. And we used to have, 150, 200 physical machines. Now these four Blade chassis were in two racks. We used to have six racks full of servers, right? Now we only had two racks. So what happened, from a cooling perspective, the system couldn't handle it because the amount of hot air actually being blown out of the Blade chassis and the storage system next to it was a lot more significant than those 1U, 2U, or even 4U servers. So when you start making changes to your design like that, make sure you take that into account. The other thing is, for instance, when you start using ESXi, and hopefully everyone is already using ESXi by now, will you use, for instance, the embedded ESXi? Will I go for USB-based a USB-based solution, or will I use an SD card or local storage, for instance? So there are some advantages and disadvantages to using these. So for instance, if you have a local disk, you kind of lose the flexibility because you need to install it on local disk. The local disk can't really move around. Then what? If you look at USB, from a resiliency perspective, at least when you have local disks, you typically end up with two disks in a RAID 1 set. If one disk fails, your environment will keep on running, right? But with USB, are you still as resilient as you are with local disks? Now, in the case of ESXi, I can tell you that you are. So with ESXi, the hypervisor itself is loaded up into memory. So even if the disk fails, ESXi will keep on running. You will need to replace it fairly quick, because at some point you will want to write some of the configuration down, but at least it won't fail immediately. Now, another option, for instance, is boot from SAN. Are people actually doing boot from SAN? Just a couple. So I started doing our boot from SAN in the 3.5 days, or 2.5 days even. And every single time I did a patch, I ended up with the purple screen of death, because it was updating my SCSI driver. And the system actually didn't like that. Now, on top of that, we started doing the math. And when we're using fairly expensive SAN storage just for an operating system, and we weren't actually moving around hosts or changing identity of hosts, so what was the real benefit for us? Well, we figured out there wasn't really a benefit. So we changed back to local disks. Now, there's another option these days, which is auto-deploy. Are people actively doing auto-deploy? Not many. Okay, that's not a good sign. But I know why. And that's one of the reasons I'm here as well. That's what I wanted to mention. Auto-deploy is a really cool solution, if you ask me. Booting ESXi over the network. No local disks. Having everything scripted. But if you look at the solution by itself, there's a lot of dependencies. What if your auto-deploy server fails? What if your Pixie server fails? What if your DHCP server is not available? And if you're running everything virtually, then those dependencies might bite you in the end. So I can tell you that VMware is working on solving a lot of these problems, making sure that the auto-deploy appliance or the solution by itself is highly resilient. But that's going to take some time. So if you're planning on using it, make sure to test it. Make sure that part of your test plans, you actually try to figure out what happens if the auto deploy server fails or if the Pixie server fails. Because I can tell you, booting up will be fairly difficult when there's no place where you can actually get the boot image from. vCenter server. And especially the web client is something that a lot of people started looking into recently. With 5.0 we introduced, yeah, that's a good comment. So with 5.1 what we introduced is what we call stateless caching. And basically what it does, it caches an image on local storage, but it also means you need to have local storage. So in a way it also kind of defeats the whole purpose of the solution. And now there's still some dependencies here and there. So although it solves a particular problem, it doesn't solve the full solution, or doesn't solve the full problem that there is around availability. So that's why I'm saying, if you start looking into scenarios like these, test them. Because I'm pretty sure you're going to hit a bottleneck and you figure out, well, USB or even boot from SAN makes a lot more sense in this case. Now, when we start talking about vCenter server, the one thing that's important to realize is that from a scalability perspective, sizing perspective, there are limits when it comes to the amount of virtual machines that vCenter can run on, or you can run in a single vCenter instance. And then there is the PDF which shows you the amount of virtual machines that theoretically you can run on a single vCenter host, or at least manage via a single vCenter host. And it says, I don't know, 10,000 at the moment. 20,000, whatever it is, I can tell you, you will never hit that limit in your environment. Because before you reach that limit, you'll start having performance issue with your vCenter server. Around 4,000, 5,000 VMs. Typically, the amount of CPU resources needed to figure out where virtual machines need to be placed, the amount of tasks that are spawned every second just to figure out for instance, by DRS, where virtual machines need to be moved to. It just takes up too many resources. So that's the point where you start looking into having a second vCenter server. I just mentioned the web client. Hopefully everyone started looking into using the web client, because the web client, from a VMware perspective, is the way forward. Now, I, as no one else, realized that it kind of feels clumsy when you start using it. It always feels like every single task takes at least twice the amount of time it used to take with the regular client. But that's something you get used to, I promise you that. Once again, the web client is the future. Now, the nice thing about the web client is it's a scale-out model. So you can have multiple web clients, web client servers up and running, and have a load balancer sitting in front of it. So one of the appliances fails, there's always another one running. Now, I just mentioned the appliance. Are people using the appliance actively? So I use it in my lab. The reason I use the appliance by itself is because it's really, you can set it up fairly quickly. Now, the downside of the appliance, it's limited to 50 virtual machines and 5 hosts. That's a testing limit. So it's not a hard limit. You can have 20 hosts, you can have 40 hosts, you can have 5,000 virtual machines. It will just keep on running. So just for your information, the VMworld Labs, which handles 30, 40, 50,000 new virtual machines in just a couple of days, they were using the vCenter appliance. So though the testing limit currently says 5 hosts and 50 VMs, it's still a viable option if you ask me. But this is something that we're going to change in one of the upcoming releases. So from a scalability perspective, the appliance will also be changed. So we'll be supporting more hosts and more virtual machines that at least most of you guys will be able to use it in your environment. We're looking into other solutions around update management as well. That's about all I can say, because people will fire me if I give you more information. But there are multiple things going on within VMware. So I don't know if anyone is doing the beta program that we are hosting currently. There's multiple beta programs going on. There's going to be something similar next year, and Update Manager is going to change. But essentially, the new version will be part of the appliance itself. So we'll make sure that you can have an appliance-based infrastructure if you desire. So on top of that, we also make sure, of course, that you can still use it on Windows or any other platform. So I already briefly mentioned this, but the data center object is one of the key things, if you ask me. The reason for it being is it's a boundary for some of the functionality. Like I said, vMotion and, for instance, DVS, so the distributed vSwitch. A lot of people assume that the cluster is actually a boundary, but a cluster isn't a boundary for anything. It's the data center level. So you can have multiple clusters within the data center and move virtual machines around between clusters if you desire. So then the next question pops up. Why would I have multiple clusters? Can I have a single cluster? Can I have multiple clusters? Well, it kind of depends on the use case. What will the environment look like? Will I have a specific DMZ that needs to be physically isolated, for instance? I've seen those out in the field. Will I be doing server virtualization, but also VDI? Well, VDI typically is installed on a separate cluster because of the type of workload. It's completely different than server workload, and it might interfere with your server workload, so you'll have a dedicated cluster for that. Are you, for instance, doing a vCloud Director? You might want to use a dedicated cluster for that as well, because vCloud Director more or less manages a cluster and creates new resource pools, and you don't want to have 2,000 new resource pools in your production cluster and not really knowing what they are doing. So those are the kind of things that you need to take into consideration. Now, on top of that, there's functionality like HA, FT, DRS, and DPM within a cluster. So we're giving away, the VMware guys are giving away 3 books, which are primarily around HA and DPM and DRS. I won't go into extreme amount of level of depth. But one of the things to realize is when people did designs in 4.1, is they always stuck to an 8-node cluster, so 8 hosts in a cluster. With 5.0 and 5.1, that's not needed anymore. So if you have 16 hosts, you can easily have them in a single cluster. The reason we used to have that 8 host limit was because of the way HA handled restarts. So we're using primary and secondary nodes, and we always needed to have a primary node available to ensure we could restart a virtual machines. With the new version of HA, that's not relevant anymore. We use this new concept, which is called master-slave. There's only one master in the cluster, and if that host fails, one of the slave nodes will pick up. So you don't need to worry about it anymore. Of course, you will still need to worry about availability from a location perspective. You might want to make sure your hosts are spread across multiple racks or multiple blade chassis, of course, because if they're all in a single blade chassis and that chassis fails, they're all gone. So as I said, from a cluster size perspective, it's a typical question I get, you know, what's a good cluster size? Well, it depends on the amount of hosts you have and your use case. Could be 6, could be 8, could be 32. I have customers who do 24 node clusters. It's a perfectly viable option. The second thing, will you be using resource pools? So how many people are using resource pools? So the next question then arises, how do you handle things like reservations, limits, shares? Are you doing anything with them? If you're not, I can highly recommend to read Frank Denneman's blog articles about shares, limits, and reservations. And the reason why is, if you're not handling those the correct way, you could end up with, for instance, a resource pool which is labeled as high with 500 virtual machines, and a resource pool which is labeled as low with 50 virtual machines. And those 50 virtual machines end up with more resources than the virtual machines in the pool of high, and just because of the way the shares mechanism works. So make sure you take that into consideration when you do your design. Yeah, so the question is, the best practice is to have a management cluster for an environment, and what is the typical size you would have for a management cluster? Now, first of all, if you ask me, there is no real best practice around having a management cluster. There is a scenario where it makes sense. So as soon as you have, let's say, 500, 1,000 virtual machines, you have 10, 15, 20 hosts, the bigger your environment gets, the more important uptime of a vCenter will be, because managing your virtual machines is part of your core business at that point. In small environments, it's a perfectly viable option just to have 3 or 4 nodes and have vCenter servers sitting up on one of those nodes. Now, in larger environments, it is indeed typically recommended to have a management cluster, and 3 nodes is what I would start off with, because if one of them fails, you at least have 2 up and running. And then if a second error issue occurs, which normally happens, right, at least there's still 1 node left and your management platform is still around. So 3 would be a good option.
And what about admission control and management cluster?
So admission control? So admission control is an easy topic for me. So with HA, if you configure vSphere HA, you have 3 different types of admission control. So you have the host failures, the amount of host failures, and you can set those from 1 to 31 with 5.0. Or you have the percentage-based, or you have the designated failover hosts. Now, my option, percentage-based, is the best option to use. The reason for it being is it's the most flexible option. If you start using reservations, you will soon figure out why it's the most flexible option, because it determines the amount of resources that are used based on a per virtual machine basis. With the host failures does it based on the largest reservation set, so which means that if you have 1 reservation set of 16 gigs, that's going to determine the amount of virtual machines you can run in a single environment. So percentage-based is, in my opinion, the way to go. Now, before I need to wrap up, storage. And I know Cormac is going to talk about storage for about 30 minutes, so he's going to handle a lot of these things, in my opinion. So one of the things that's important to realize as soon as you start doing your design is, for instance, is your storage system VAI capable? Is there a VASA plugin? So what is VAI? VAI is a way of offloading specific tasks to your storage array. Scott spoke about offloading specific networking tasks to your network controllers. Storage at the moment does something similar with VAI. So for instance, a clone, you can offload that to the storage array. That is, if your storage array supports that. Now, you will notice when your storage array doesn't support it, A clone might take 30 minutes or 40 minutes. When your storage array at least has a smart way of implementing VAI, sometimes it takes 30 seconds just to clone a virtual machine, which is 500 gigs large, for instance. Or when you create a thick disk, an EagerZero thick disk. I don't know if people use EagerZero thick disk for performance reasons. I use it on some of the databases. If you create an EagerZero thick disk on an array that doesn't support VAI, it's going to write zeros to every single block. And that takes a lot of time when you have a 500 gig disk or a terabyte disk. With VAI, basically you tell the storage array to handle that for you. So creating a thick disk, EagerZero thick disk, takes a split second. Of course, again, depending on the way the storage vendor implemented it. And this is also something that you will need to discuss with your storage vendor, if you ask me.